when I was 13 years old, I came from Vienna, my home, to Frankfurt to study with Clara Schumann. A few months after my arrival, I met Brahms for the first time in Frau Schumann's house. He was staying with her and played in the Museum Kammermusikabend his C minor trio opus 101, first performance with Hugo Hermann and Hugo Becker. My enthusiasm was great, and when Frau Schumann introduced me to Brahms with a few warm words, I thought that nobody in the world could be happier than I. Never can I forget this performance, and the trio remains my favorite for life. I will play the beginning of the second movement. Frau Schumann gave a small party at that time and played with Brahms, Akatamin, his variations on a theme by Schumann, opus 23. Brahms came every year to Frankfurt and played some new work of his in the museum for the first time. The D minor violin sonata made a tremendous impression upon me. No wonder I became an ardent Brahmsian when I was 15 years old. I knew, of course, all his piano music, but also was familiar with his symphonies, songs, and the Requiem. His music was clear to me. I was, so to speak, brought up with it. In 1891, when I was 18 years old, I started my career in Vienna with two recitals. Soon after, I played the Schumann concerto in the Vienna Philharmonic Concert, conducted by Hans Richter, and Beethoven's Emperor Concerto in the Gewandhaus Concert in Leipzig, conducted by Karl Reinecke. Shortly before I left Frankfurt, Frau Schumann gave a musical party at her house with the following program: Beethoven Sonata, opus 111, Ilona Ibensen. Songs by Brahms, Stockhausen. Schumann Carnival, Clara Schumann. Brahms was the president of the Vienna Tonkünstlerverein, and nearly all the members were professional musicians. Every month, they arranged a musical evening, and a great many foreign artists who came to Vienna played there. After my recitals, I was asked to play one evening, as was also the famous cellist Grützmacher from Dresden. It was not an easy matter playing to an audience that consisted of all the best musicians in Vienna and Brahms. I had already played the Etude Symphonique by Schumann and a few smaller pieces by Brahms and Scarlatti, when Professor Anton Dohr, the vice president of the Tonkünstlerverein, came with a letter to tell the audience that Herr Grützmacher had sent word in the last minute that he was unable to play. Brahms came up to me and said, "Now do play the opus 111 by Beethoven." I did so, and I believe that from that moment Brahms was my friend. At supper, after the concert, I had to sit next to him. He wished to know all my plans and what Frau Schumann wanted me to do. I told him she had arranged with Mr. Arthur Chappell to to engage me for 2 Monday popular concerts in London, and that I was just going to London for the first time. In June, after my return from England, I was with my family in Ischl. We were there every summer for about 3 months. I loved Ischl. It is the most enchanting place. At that time, it was very quiet. The real season beginning only in July, when the Emperor Franz Joseph was there. Brahms came to Ischl already in May. He preferred it to Switzerland and the Tyrol. In fact, nowhere else was he so happy. I had been in Ischl a few days when one afternoon Brahms paid me a visit. It was a great moment for me, and I felt very happy. I had to tell him all about London. Everything interested him, especially that Mr. Arthur Chappell engaged me at once for 4 more concerts that I had played at the Crystal Palace, Bach Choir, Halle Concert in Manchester, Cambridge and Oxford. In March 1891, his G major string quintet was performed for the first time by Joachim, Piatti, Ries, Strauss and Gibson at the Monday Pop. At the same concert, I played with Joachim and Piatti Beethoven's Trio Opus 97, and therefore heard the last 2 rehearsals. When I told Brahms how carefully Joachim had rehearsed the quintet and what a splendid reception it met with, he was very pleased. A few days later, Brahms came to dinner with us, 1 o'clock, Mittagessen. He soon made it his habit to come to us once nearly every week for dinner. He liked being with us because we made no fuss whatever with him. Never asked anybody to meet Brahms, even the Mittagessen was very simple. Quite close to us, Johann Strauss had a beautiful large villa, and we were often invited there. Brahms greatly admired Johann Strauss, who had a delightful personality. During a dinner party at Frau Johann Strauss, his stepdaughter Alice asked Brahms for an autograph. He wrote a few bars of the famous Blue Danube Waltz by Johann Strauss, and under it, unfortunately not by Johannes Brahms. We had a tremendous lot of music in Ischl, though we traveling musicians were supposed to be there for a rest. The Kneisel Quartet from America came for their holiday to Ischl. They were all Austrians, to be with their old teacher, Professor Grün. There came also Arthur Nikisch with his family, Leschetizky, Edward Schütt, Gustav Mahler, and a great many musicians from all over the world. And also my great friend Bösendorfer, who sent a lovely piano to Ischl for me every summer for the 3 months I was there. When Ali Strauss became engaged, Frau Johann Strauss gave a party, and the Kneisel Quartet and I played Brahms' G minor quartet. Nikisch turned over for me. We played in high spirits, with Brahms as listener in a comfortable chair with a big cigar. Soon after this, Kneisel came to me one morning to play the 3 violin sonatas by Brahms. He had fixed the day, and we asked only Nikisch, Kössler, Wendt, and Professor Grün to come and listen. But I told Brahms he might come if he liked, and to our great pleasure, he came. After the sonata, I played the B minor ballade, and Frau Nikisch sang, accompanied by her husband. Brahms liked music in small company. Now I will play the beginning of the ballade. Thank you. Mürfel, the clarinetist, came to Ischl for one day to pay visit to Brahms and played with the Kneidl Quartet Brahms clarinet quintet. This was the most wonderful performance I ever heard. It took place at Kneidl's house. The audience consisted of Brahms, Herren von Steinbach, Herren von Nikisch, and myself. Mühlfeld played marvelously on his clarinet. And when they had finished playing this heavenly work, we were all so moved that nobody found a word to say. But Nikisch fell on his knee before Brahms, and that exactly expressed our feelings. I was traveling a great deal, but had the good fortune to be in Vienna to hear Brahms play his two clarinet sonatas with Mühlfeld at a small party at Frau Anna Franz Wittgenstein. I turned over for Brahms. But there was still a greater, unforgettable pleasure for me. When in 1892, one day after dinner, Brahms said, "Oh, I want to play you, well, a few exercises which I have just composed." Only Professor Wendt and my family were present, but he would not allow them to enter the music room, and they had to listen outside on the stairs. He just tried the piano and then began to play the G minor ballade, Intermezzi, the Rhapsody in E flat. In fact, all the Klavierstücke opus 118 and 119. He played as if he were just improvising, with heart and soul, sometimes humming to himself, forgetting everything around him. His playing was altogether grand and noble, like his compositions. It was, of course, the most wonderful thing for me to hear these pieces, as nobody yet knew anything about them. I was the first to whom he played them. When he finished playing, I was very excited and hardly knew what to say. I murmured only that I must write to Frau Schumann about them at once. He looked at me and said, "But you did not like them." "How can you possibly say such a thing to me?" I asked. And he answered, with a twinkle in his eye, "You did not ask da capo for a single piece." I had the presence of mind to say, "I want them all da capo, but not today." He laughed, and a few days later, played them to me again. A few months after, at the Monday Popular Concert in London, I gave them their first public performance. Of course, I wrote to Frau Schumann about the Klavierstücke at once. In a letter dated September 1892, she wrote to Brahms after a very sad misunderstanding. "So let us, dear Johannes, resume our friendship, for which your new Klavierstücke, about which Ilona has written to me, afford the best opportunity if you are willing. Receive greetings in the old affectionate way from your Clara." Brahms to Clara Schumann, Ischl, August 1893. "Yesterday, your Ilona was here, and because she is yours and your letter came, I played her all the pieces. I shall now play the Intermezzo opus 119 in E minor.